The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
It's Empty Wheel Friday on the Nicole Sandler Show.
Ah, and the stereo kicked in. It is a Friday. We are here. I'm Nicole Sandler. Marcy Wheeler joins me from emptywheel.net on Fridays. It's the second voyage from the new studio at the new house. So I apologize in advance for any technical mishaps. Bad lighting. Hopefully the audio works. And here we are. It's been a week. And I'm not quite sure what went on in the world because I am moved. Trying to move while you're trying to, you know, keep working and stay abreast of what's going on in the world is kind of hard, but I have no more excuses after today. So it's all, no more excuses after today. Marcy Wheeler, we're here. Fingers crossed that things are working. How are you?
I've lost track of another week.
You and me both. And so Kamala Harris was actually in my town last night. I didn't go because I've been moving, but she did another huge rally. So the last time she was in the Phoenix area, she was in Glendale, which is the West Valley. This time she was in Chandler, which is where I live, in the East Valley. I've been so scattered this week and trying to get moved out of the old house because we had to be out by 10 o'clock this morning. So, but apparently she packed the place again and the response was awesome. And, it's giving me some hope.
And Tim Walz was actually in your area as well.
I heard that. I'm so unaware of what went on.
One of the things he did, I mean, he did a public event, but one of the things he did is he did an event with the Gila River tribe. And there were representatives from at least the Navajo. And I actually watched that. I was just sort of curious. And I watched it and it was super interesting because, first of all, he's done this in Minnesota. Minnesota has a significant Native American population as well. Totally different tribes, but Native American population. And they were talking about the get out the vote efforts, but they also were talking about Peggy Flanagan, who of course is his lieutenant governor. And if he wins, she will be the first elected woman Native to govern a state. Stitt in Oklahoma is Native, is like it there, you know, there are people who claim Native American heritage, and then there are questions of whether or not you're enrolled or not. But this was a big deal. Like they were like, first of all, we know that you work really well with Peggy Flanagan, but second of all, if you get promoted to vice president, then Peggy Flanagan becomes the governor. So it was an interesting, because again, obviously there are, I think, 300,000 Native Americans in Arizona, a ton in Alaska, mm-hmm. And significant numbers in states like Minnesota. I mean, in Montana, where, you know, John Tester looks like he's doing poorly, but his opponent's mistreatment of Native Americans is a key issue there. So it was an interesting, you know, like there are huge events. Like we can talk about Obama like teeing up on Donald Trump last night.
Oh yeah.
But it was an interesting thing because if they turn out Native Americans at a higher number than you normally see in Arizona, and it's really hard to do, right? Because the Navajo reservation in particular is vast and that was one thing I did this week that was sort of interesting.
Well, cool. And actually the event that Kamala Harris did here in Chandler, except it was the Gila River reservation. I don't know what building on the property, but that's where her rally in Chandler was. So it's sort of Chandler adjacent because it's the Gila River, but that's where it was.
It's right here. I mean, that reservation is a big chunk of South Phoenix.
That's so right. And sort of the area that I'm now living, closer to where I'm living now than before. It's 7 miles away, but anyway. Yeah, so she was here. I do know some people who went, but honestly, I haven't had time to turn around. But you did mention Obama. So Obama is going all in. I've only caught some clips online. He's pulling no punches. Let's see if I can play this audio. So here's just one clip.
Well, before you play, can I say one thing?
Absolutely.
Right. So I think most people assume this race is going to come down to who turns out their voters better. Right.
I got to stop you here. Isn't it always? I mean, it's all about who gets
vote out. But it's super close. Like, I think that people going into this election understand that it's going to be as close as 2020 was. In 2020, people didn't understand how close the race is going to be. So going into this, the question is who can turn out their voters better? Donald Trump, first of all, is using this wacky system that really was only rolled out in Iowa, where he was going to win anyway. And short of that, he's outsourced it to Elon Musk, who's spending $500 million. And Elon Musk is working with the people that Ron DeSantis lost badly with in places like Iowa. And Cook Politico reporting had an interesting stat. They've been chasing this stat for a while, which is that Kamala Harris is winning by a good amount among high turnout voters, suburban voters, college educated voters. Uh-huh. And Trump is winning by a bigger margin among low turnout voters. So in other words, Kamala's voters are going to turn out for them. And we're seeing that in states like Michigan already, that it seems like far more of their high propensity voters will be banked, will be done. Like, I'm done. You know, the campaign knows they don't have to go chase my vote because it arrived in September. And so that'll leave them more time to turn out less likely voters, whereas Donald Trump has this uphill climb across the board because he's got far greater support from working class voters and they turn out at a lower rate. So that's the general scope of the race. But then there are pockets of the traditional Democratic coalition where there's more concern. And the one of those areas is especially young, but black men generally, but especially younger black men. So that's the background to Barack Obama coming out. And it explains some of what he was saying last night is that, you know, he was suggesting almost that there are enough black men who are uncomfortable with a woman being the president, that he was kind of needling them about that. But they're going to use Obama in areas especially to target black male voters. And so that's one of the things you're seeing on the Democratic side, whereas on the Republican side, they're like, we're going to bring out the richest man in the world, claim he's a populist. Like this rally that they had in Butler last weekend was incredible because it wasn't just Elon Musk. It was also John Paulson, who significantly caused the 2008 crisis because he shorted all of these housing stocks. Wow. And he made a billion off of it or something like that. But, you know, like you're bringing these like some of the richest people in the world and in fact, the richest men in the world onto the stage claiming that you're a populist and that's your idea of get out the vote. Now, no one should be complacent at all. You know, you're seeing polls that reflect working class men who are increasingly saying we believe Donald Trump's garbage. Right. Mm-hmm. You're seeing that. And no one knows how the hurricanes are going to affect Georgia and North Carolina. Now, this week, Republicans in both Georgia and North Carolina were like, we're not going to make any special rules for the people who've been impacted by the hurricanes. And you know, there's a big chunk, like obviously Asheville is a key part of, they're going to vote Democratic,
sure,
but they're closer to being online again than other parts of Western North Carolina, which are even more rural. And so that, you know, in a sense, these states are fucking over Donald Trump voters, but this is something that is going to be in the background of not just turnout, but also polling for the next couple of weeks.
Right. But okay. So this brings us to, and I'm jumping ahead here, but the lying, the mendacity has just gone nuts. So the government controls the weather, don't you know? And it's Biden and Harris who are pushing the buttons to make these hurricanes hit Republican air. I mean, what kind of shit are they spewing? And people are believing it.
A number of people are believing it. Yes. There, you know, and it was interesting because there were these articles maybe over the weekend. Like everyone did their, okay, 30 days. What does the 30 days?
Oh, shit. damn it. Hold on. I'm sorry. I'm an idiot. I tried to fix the light and I screwed up. I will edit it. We'll pick this up. It'll come back.
Okay.
Sorry, squaw. I'll scratch the retinal. Sorry, squaw. I'll scratch the retinal. Sorry, squaw. I'll scratch the retinal. Sorry, squaw.
We had a little technical difficulty, and we still do because I just rebuilt my studio and some wires are crossed somewhere. So we're going to continue audio only because, you know, this is radio. Anyway, that's where I come from. So Marcy Wheeler, sorry about all the problems. They'll be fixed by next week. So do you remember what we were talking about?
Obama and the need to turn out various groups of voters. And I was describing that Obama was trying to make sure Black men do turn out in numbers that, I mean, obviously Black men turned out in bigger numbers in 2008 than they did in 2020. And so he's trying to bring those numbers back up because that gets you a lot closer to a solid win.
Okay, got that. So so Obama is on the road. I know I can play audio here. So here's one of his just showing that he's not holding back anything. He's going after Trump, like, with both barrels. Well, that's the wrong metaphor to use. He's going after Trump, not holding anything back. How's that? Better than
a little inhibition.
Bring order to the border and fix our immigration system. The bipartisan deal that Kamala Harris supported, even though it was written by one of the most conservative Republicans in Congress, the same bill that Donald Trump tanked on purpose because he thinks fear-mongering is how he's going to win this election. He told Republicans, even the ones who had originally supported, don't vote for it, because he doesn't want the problem solved. We don't need a president who will make problems worse just to make his own political circumstances better. We need a president who actually cares about solving problems and making your life better. And that's what Kamala Harris will do.
And he went on and on. I mean, and he kept going. I see another clip up here that in the list that I'm looking at that I pulled, where he talks about, he said, yet when Donald Trump lies or cheats or shows utter disregard for our Constitution, when he calls POWs losers or fellow citizens vermin, people make excuses for it. They think it's okay. They think at least he is owning the libs. You know, we were out dealing with the move, and I can't even begin to tell you, it's been one thing after another, but we're in the auto repair shop where we had to have the van towed because the transmission went out on the van we borrowed with a load of our crap in it yesterday, fun day. And a guy walks in wearing a Veterans for Trump t-shirt. I'm telling you, David had to just hold me in my seat because I wanted to say, do you have no self-respect? How can you be a veteran for Trump? There was one other thing, let me tell you. So from the repair shop, they give us a ride back to the house because the van is out of commission now. And my husband, as he does, talks to everybody and he says, so are you registered to vote? And she said, no, I don't vote. Like, you don't. And so I was speechless. The movers, we had three guys moving the furniture on Tuesday, I think it was. Three movers. And again, David's like, so are you voting? One guy said, yep, I'm in it. I'm ready. I'm ready to go. Another said he wasn't registered. And he means to, but he wasn't registered. But I think it's too late because early voting has started in Arizona. And the third one said, yes, but I don't know who I'm voting for yet. These are regular people. And I don't get how anyone can be undecided at this point. Do you think it's just that they are so disconnected from the news, from the world, from what's going on? Or are they just ignorant?
Well, I mean, let's take a step back because this is the other thing I was going to say, because we were talking about the hurricane relief.
Yes.
And they, New York Times and Washington Post did these two stories. They're like 30 days out. Here's what's going on. And the Washington Post only wanted to talk about ad spending. And it was like, this race will not be decided by ad spending. This race will be decided by who gets there's like, we're all like the best information we have is that each candidate has the same number of voters in the key swing states, mm-hmm. or at least, you know, certainly Pennsylvania. Okay. So if you have the same number of voters, it kind of stands to reason that the race will be decided by who gets more of their voters out.
Right.
Kind of basic. And who gets them counted, which is another issue, but who gets them out? That's the first step. Get them out. And Washington Post didn't really want to talk about the fact that, you know, Donald Trump has outsourced his GOTV to Elon Musk, who is relying on the same guys who spectacularly lost the Ron DeSantis case and are still hiring people to do this job. The New York Times one was much more honest. They're like, you know, obviously Harris has far better GOTV on the ground. She's got this infrastructure that Trump doesn't have.
Right.
Along the way, by the way, Maggie's one of the authors of this, one of the fiction writers of this. And uh-huh. along the way, she describes why Hillary lost in 2016, even though Hillary had better, better infrastructure in 2016 as well. And never mentioned the hostile attack by Russian intelligence against Hillary Clinton that New York Times was a key facilitator of.
Right.
Like, why are we covering up the fact that New York Times was fundamentally part of a Russian attack in 2016? I don't know. Oh, because Maggie Haberman is on. But down below, the New York Times quoted a bunch of Republicans saying, yeah, we do have concerns about GOTV. And then in this article bylined by Maggie Haberman and others, they said, well, Trump's people say that they're not worried, one, because of all of the bad news, meaning meaning Israel's expanding invasions,
right,
and the hurricanes.
Yes.
And I was like, it is true that Israel, that Bibi Netanyahu is on top of all the humanitarian catastrophe that he is causing with the facilitation of the United States, bipartisan facilitation
yes.
of the United States.
Yeah.
Netanyahu, you know, that is going to do things that we can't predict in Michigan, certainly in Michigan, Georgia as well, but Michigan, it could swing the state. Absolutely.
Yes.
But the hurricane, and I was like, you just wrote that down, New York Times. You didn't question what you were being fed at all. And in a world where you had competent journalism, first of all, you would never repeat that. But second of all, a journalist would say, this is a dumbass argument from Trump's people, because in fact, the response to these twin hurricanes, this was actually before Milton landed, but uh-huh. the response to these hurricanes has been really as well as you can expect, right? You've got Republican governors saying, yeah, they had stuff headed out before we even asked, and they've given us everything we wanted, and I'm really pleased, and they're very responsive, and Biden or Harris contacts me every day. You know, it's a little bit different with both DeSantis and Lee, Florida and Tennessee, because yeah. both of them are like, we can do it on our own.
Yeah.
And then DeSantis is like, ah, fuck, I can't do it on my own. So
yeah, but
they delayed
so,
their requests
right.
for help. And but regardless, like, the hurricane response has been competent, but
yes.
as you noted, Donald Trump, with the facilitation, with the participation of Elon Musk, are like, fuck it, we'll just make shit up.
Yeah.
We will make shit up. We will say Democrats control the weather and they purposely
oh my God.
Brought this hurricane to Western North Carolina as a way to cheat. I mean, that, you know, and this is when you say, why is it these people don't understand? We have to talk about the fact that, first of all, news has been gutted.
Yeah.
News has been systematically discredited, both partly of their own doing, and shit like this from New York Times really contributes to it.
That's
aggressively.
Right. Yep.
But also, you have places, I mean, certainly where I used to live in Michigan, well, not in Grand Rapids itself, but much of Michigan is a news desert. The local news has disappeared. I mean, I say this from time to time. One of the things that is most remarkably telling, remarkably different here in Ireland is that there's hyper localized news,
mm-hmm.
right? Like
mm-hmm.
there's a radio station that plays pop music, but also has death notices.
Oh.
They do rugby news. and they talk about the local fair and, you know, the tractor pull. It's all the same radio station. It's great. It's amazing. Mm-hmm. It's super localized. Mm-hmm. There's two local newspapers that are still very vibrant. This is a town of, you know, basically 100,000 people. You wouldn't find that in the United States,
no,
right?
Right.
And so people are relying on Elon Musk's shitter or Mark Zuckerberg's Meta. And yeah, both of them have said, we want Donald Trump to win because we want to keep, you know, the start of it is we want our tax cuts to be renewed. Ugh. We want to keep gutting the U.S. economy. We want to, undermine the U.S. dollar. This is what I think this week Zuckerberg became the second richest man in the world for this week. And so this is who backs Donald Trump. And they're the ones who are feeding these news deserts. They're the ones who are providing what counts as news to these news deserts. And instead of news, they're getting people making shit up about Democrats controlling the weather. And that is really where we're at.
Right.
Like, where, you know, Donald Trump routinely deliberately bullies the news.
Yeah.
The news responds by being cowed.
Yep.
They today, like, let me jump ahead and say that the New York Times did a 2,200 piece on Elon Musk's intervention for Donald Trump. Doesn't mention J.D. Vance's role in that. Doesn't mention the corruption involved, the quid pro quo involved. Mm-hmm. But like, even crazier is, like, the end of the article, 2,200 words. The end of the article has, like, six paragraphs on Elon Musk's what they call misinformation. Remember, misinformation is if you're too stupid to know that it's false.
And
disinformation is if you know it's false and spread it anyway.
Right.
They call it misinformation. So that's false.
Right.
And in their coverage of the what they call misinformation, which is disinformation, which is therefore their disinformation now, they talk about Elon Musk insulting Harris. They don't talk about him twice joking about how no one has tried to kill her.
Right.
They don't mention that. Ugh. They don't mention his deliberate magnification of this garbage, deliberate disinformation about the hurricanes. Before that, it was Haitians eating cats and dogs.
That's right.
They don't mention that this summer, Elon Musk deliberately stoked far-right political violence in the UK.
Wow.
Anti-migrant violence in the UK, saying, you know, it's inevitable, we're going to have civil war. So they don't mention the really dangerous, going to get people killed part of this. So they're going to get Haitians in Springfield killed, going to get people who should be should be going to FEMA to get $750 to make it to the larger application. They're not going to go because Elon Musk has told them not to. So they don't mention that. And then the big thing that everyone noticed is that in the 23rd paragraph of this article.
Yeah.
23rd paragraph, 2,200 word article. They're like, oh, Donald Trump's campaign asked Musk not to publish the dossier on J.D. Vance that Iran stole from the campaign.
Uh-huh.
Now, I've said this. I'm okay with people choosing not to publish this stuff. But if you're the New York Times, you shouldn't be burying the fact that you helped Russian spies put Donald Trump in office. Well, while you're pretending to have learned your lesson here. But of course, what this was is exactly what the far right, including Donald Trump, including J.D. Vance, including Elon Musk, have said for years constituted censorship.
Mm-hmm.
This is mm-hmm. exactly what, you know, Elon Musk, I'm a First Amendment purist.
Right.
And that claim is literally based on the foundation of the Hunter Biden, quote unquote, laptop. It was actually a hard drive.
Right.
So there you had a known Russian information operation with Rudy Giuliani getting on a plane and going visit Andrei Derkach to go get dirt on Hunter Biden. He gets dirt on Hunter Biden, then all of a sudden comes out with a laptop, which, by the way, could be associated. We still do not know to this day. However, it was fair for Facebook and Twitter to think this is associated with the public Russian disinformation operation involving Rudy Giuliani. Rudy Giuliani is the one who's got the laptop. This is so simple. It's painful. And so Twitter and Facebook, whether, you know, whatever you think of the decision, they throttled this New York Post story for a day of their own decision, because they knew about this other Russian disinformation operation, which is public and known and involved Russian spies. And Elon Musk, Donald Trump, J.D. Vance have used that as a foundation of a bullshit claim that the left is censoring right-wing speech. And in fact, and they say this routinely, like Donald Trump's excuse for not sitting for a 60 Minutes interview is that back in 2020, they said they were not reporting on the laptop because they couldn't verify it. He's saying 4 years later, you caused me to lose the election in 2020 because you wouldn't report on something that my own lawyer refused to give you enough information such that you could verify or not, right? They're still claiming that this decision to throttle the laptop for 2 days decided the 2020 election. And meanwhile, Elon Musk, again, I'm fine with New York Times. I'm fine with Twitter. I'm fine with Meta saying we don't want to publish stuff stolen by Iranian hackers. But Elon Musk not only throttled it, but got rid of Ken Klippenstein, the journalist who posted it in the first place.
Right.
He's gone. He's been banned from Twitter. And so it is an actual instance where the campaign intervened, where Elon Musk himself, we're going to throttle this, got rid of Ken Klippenstein altogether. It's exactly what they claim the Democrats did in 2020. Yep. They're lying.
Yep.
They're doing it now. And New York Times decides to put that in paragraph 23. of an article also claiming that Elon Musk doesn't know that he's spreading disinformation, rather than the headline, which is Elon Musk is a First Amendment hypocrite and he's using it to help Donald Trump get elected.
Without a doubt. This, again, you just verbalized what I call opposite world.
Everything you thought you knew, you never knew it all. Sideways is straight ahead. Facts no longer matter. Reality is now fiction. There's a signpost up ahead. Your next stop, opposite world.
The projection is just off the charts. Everything that they do, they accuse the Democrats of doing it when they're the ones doing it. It's the gaslighting. It's, I don't know how else to describe it. I mean, it's gaslighting. It's projection. It's opposite world. And it goes on and on. I mean, from, you know, we learned, you know, Bob Woodward has a book out, another book out called War. And in it, he talks about there are two former aides to Trump who talked about him not wanting to give any relief to California after the huge wildfires that took place. I don't remember what year it was, but while he was in office. And he didn't want to give money to California because California didn't vote for him. And his aides had to show him maps and show where people who voted for him were in California and that he had to help them. That shouldn't be a question in the first place. It doesn't matter. California is a state in the United States that needed relief, and he wanted to withhold funds because they didn't vote for him. That's what he's accusing the Biden administration now of doing, and it's all bullshit.
There's a lot that he's accusing them of. I mean, he's accusing them of that. He's accusing them of diverting money from FEMA emergency response to
migrants.
Housing for migrants. That's something Donald Trump did. If we had a functioning press, they would nonstop be hammering the fact that most of the members of Congress that represent these areas covered by the hurricane voted against FEMA funding literally days before these hurricanes made landfall. Like Representative Luna represents Tampa Bay.
Yep.
And she voted against FEMA and then started making shit up about it. She got corrected on the FEMA so that at least her constituents know that they can get free money from FEMA. That's they're entitled to it as Americans, right? But she, You know, we should be talking about the fact that this is what Republicans want to do. They want to get rid of FEMA altogether, so there will be no response. So what you will have is a privatized response. Donald Trump, billionaires come in and help only the people who are loyal to the billionaires.
Right.
And we don't get common good. There's no coverage of the 9 times Donald Trump really did disastrous things with hurricanes. Like, for example, he's like, oh, I've never heard of a Category 5 hurricane. It's like, well, you know, Hurricane Maria,
yeah,
which hit Puerto Rico,
that's right,
under your under your administration, Category 5, devastated the island. You gave them nothing.
Oh, paper towels. You gave North them paper towels.
None of their requested aid.
Right.
Then there was the time you threw, I mean, back to the Maria, you literally threw paper towels.
Exactly.
At people in Puerto Rico.
Yep.
And, you know, like, let's be talking about this, because Puerto Ricans aren't all in Puerto Rico, especially after Maria devastated the island. Some of them are now Florida voters.
That's right. Yep.
Let's make sure they remember that Donald Trump was, you know, provided disastrous response. The Sharpie, right? Like, oh, I don't want to talk about the fact that a hurricane just hit a state that I care about. So I'm just going to take a pen and pretend that it's somewhere else. I mean, it is insane how bad Donald Trump's disaster response always was.
Always.
And, you know, and what we're seeing, again, even the Republican governors are saying this, it's never easy when people lose their livelihoods. It's never easy when people lose their homes, but there is a tremendous effort to get there and help people and find people and clear out the debris. And the notion that New York Times wouldn't say that in their story and instead provide the basis for this disinformation. And then when they talk about Elon Musk's role in the campaign, to ignore that part of it is just really painfully corrupt, painfully cynical. Or maybe they're just stupid. I don't know. But, you know, this is basic stuff. Like, they told you something that made no sense. And I read it and I was like, well, what they're telling you is that they plan to make shit up.
Yeah.
And that should be a story in and of its own, in and of itself.
Right.
And not only did you not report that, but then when you reported on Elon Musk's role, you literally just turned it into a puff piece. Misinformation, not disinformation. Let's ignore the parts that are going to get people killed. Let's ignore the laughing about assassination attempts at Vice President Harris. This is, it's just completely irresponsible.
And beyond, because, okay, here's another example just to expand on that. For months, all we heard about is, oh, Joe Biden's old. He can't string a sentence together. He can't finish a thought. Well, Donald Trump on any day puts Joe Biden to shame in that category. So yesterday, I think it was yesterday, Trump is in Detroit and he's speaking to the Detroit Economic Club. And let me just play a little clip of something he said there.
A very big plant. Many countries, they do that. And then all of a sudden you hear that they're leaving Milwaukee or they're leaving wherever they may be located. It's very sad to see it. And it's so simple. I mean, you know, this isn't like Elon with his rocket ships that land within 12 inches on the moon where they wanted to land. Or he gets the engines back. That was the first I realized. I said, who the hell did that? I saw engines about 3-4 years ago. These things were coming, cylinders, no wings, no nothing. And they're coming down very slowly, landing on a raft in the middle of the ocean someplace with a circle. Boom. Reminded me of the Biden circles that he used to have, right?
What?
He'd have 8 circles and he couldn't fill them up.
This guy's but then I heard he beat us in front of tens of thousands of people.
Yeah.
And it's not being reported as such.
Right. He's lost his mind. What fucking circles? I don't know. He makes no sense. He rambles on and then makes excuse for his rambling. The guy is seriously lost whatever marbles he had in the first place. And where's the reporting on that? Where are the demands for him to step down?
Right. I mean, just like, you know, there's just a handful of people, but they're in key roles in especially the New York Times coverage. And they not only minimize the craziness of what Donald Trump says, but they also minimize how this free association, which we just heard, they take that out. Well, it was rambling. Well, what do you mean by rambling? It was insane.
Yes.
I mean, it was, I take that back. It wasn't insane, no. But it was not rational.
Okay.
Whatever the cause of the lack of rationality in Donald Trump's speech, and we can come up with possible explanations, but we don't need to.
No.
Like, the man does not exhibit rationality when he speaks publicly anymore. And you got to tell people that.
Right. The other thing, he's speaking in Detroit, and later on, I think it was in this clip or another one, whatever, he says, if Kamala Harris gets into office, the whole country is going to be Detroit. It's going to be horrible. And he's there. I mean, who's advising? I mean, is anyone advising him? Does he just say things, and do people just not pay attention?
Yeah, it wasn't clear to people whether, to be sure, people in the Detroit Economic Club, many of them are going to live in the suburbs.
Yeah.
But not as many as did in 2020 and not as many in 2016, because Detroit is really exhibiting a renaissance. So there's these high-end condos downtown where you're going to have rich people live, which wasn't true in 2008, right? Uh-huh. Detroit is changing, and even people who live in Oakland care about the image of Detroit because that's where their culture is, that's where their sports teams are, yada yada, right? So he attacks Detroit, and people are like, well, is it that he doesn't know he's in Detroit, or is that he just has this image? I mean, he says similar things about Milwaukee before he did the RNC there, right? Like, he just needs people to believe that these predominantly African-American cities are shitholes, right?
Yep.
And they're not. Like, Detroit is experiencing a renaissance. You had major campaign events from both parties in Milwaukee, and they went off swimmingly, and they were lovely. I saw a thing this week which said four of the most dynamic real estate, the tightest real estate markets in the country, Chicago's one. I was like, damn, those people at the DNC are going to discover what a lovely city Chicago is. I was just talking to somebody here in Ireland about what a lovely city it is. Like, now they're onto it. But also three in Michigan,
right.
Lansing, Detroit, and Grand Rapids, where I used to live. And, obviously people want to live in these cities, and you're calling them shitholes. I hope it costs him some vote. I hope that his hopes to convert black voters, for example, they'll hear that and they'll get really, they'll figure out that he really thinks they're inhuman, subhuman.
Yes.
But the other news from this week,
because
this is another good clip that I don't know if you can, if you've got or whether you can put in later.
Let's see.
Is it was discovered that the Bibles Donald Trump is selling at a million % markup.
Yes.
$3 Bibles that sell for $60, right?
Yes. And actually, Obama mentioned that. Obama spoke about it in one of his things. Let me see if I can.
And Walls did too. Like, Walls is like, this is the guy who outsourced even his printing of his Bible. He outsourced God to China.
Yeah.
Which is a great line from Walls. And then Walls is like, I'll give him an out on this one, because you know what? Where it says made in China, it's inside the Bible where he did, he'll never find it.
Well, it's true. I mean, and that's the thing. That's so the blinders that people have on about him. I just don't understand how they can look up to this man who lies to them at every turn.
One more thing about campaign news this week, which is worth mentioning, is that the polling is beginning to show some concerning things. I've heard that what we're seeing is white working class voters still do believe that Donald Trump is better for the economy. Oh. And we'll see whether Kamala Harris can turn that around in the next couple of weeks. But that's where you're seeing some shift in certain polls, but not other polls. But New York Times showed Harris taking more of a lead than they had showed in the past at the national level. And one of the sources of that change is that last month, 5% of Republicans said they were going to vote for Harris. In this most recent poll, 9% did. And then Bulwark did some focus groups and polling on Nikki Haley voters, and a pretty significant percentage of Nikki Haley voters are similarly saying that they're going to vote for Harris. And so one of the, you know, I've got two or three big questions about this election. One, I already said, are events in Israel going to lead Arabs and Muslims in Michigan, especially, to not vote or vote for Jill Stein or vote for Trump? That is a real worry. Yep. But another, you know, another one of this turnout question that I've been talking about. But the third is, did all of the time that Harris spent investing in doing things like the campaign appearance with Liz Cheney, getting those endorsements from Republicans, these Republicans are doing really interesting events around these swing states. And they're obviously events targeted to Republicans, targeted to convincing Republicans that they need to actually cast a vote for Kamala Harris. And at least those two data points suggest that it's working, suggest that it's working on a level that could make a difference in some of these swing states. And that, and that, depending on polling methodology, may result in people misunderstanding polling, result in outdated turnout models. So we'll see.
Well, and the whole whole focus on polling still pisses me off, because when's the last time that polling in a presidential race was on target? I mean, it's useful as an indicator of trends, maybe, but to base everything on the polls, if the polls were right, Hillary Clinton would have been president, and Obama and Trump never would have been in the Oval Office.
Yeah, and the other thing about polling is that Republicans, the Nate Silver model, Republicans have figured out a way to turn that into propaganda by doing these very, very propagandistic polls. I saw somebody show that in the last week or so, half of all the polls that have come out are these garbage propaganda polls. Uh-huh. And the problem with doing the Nate Silver 538 model, when you know you're getting that kind of garbage, is because Republicans are deliberately doing this to create expectations that they can then exploit and create political violence down the road.
It's a mess. Here's one of those the clips of Obama with the not only the Bible but the other scams that Trump is perpetrating on the American people.
Constant attempts to sell you stuff. Who does that? Selling you gold sneakers and a $100,000 watch and most recently a Trump Bible. He wants you to buy the Word of God, Donald Trump edition. Got his name right there next to Matthew and Luke. I mean, you could not make this stuff up. If you saw it on Saturday Night Live, you'd say, well, no, that's going too far. No, he's doing that.
He's doing that, and these idiots are falling for it. It doesn't make me very confident about the American people. And then there's the other issue. I have no doubt, Marcy, that Kamala Harris will win the popular vote, just like Hillary Clinton did, just like Joe Biden did. What worries me are all the games, the shenanigans, and they're not fun games, they're scams, and Trump is so good at scamming everybody that they're going to pull and to try to, you know, lie, cheat, and steal their way in, all the while accusing Democrats of doing exactly what they're doing.
Right.
So, that
frightens
me.
Meanwhile, one of the things I love is none of the swing state Republican candidates for Senate actually live in those states. Like, we've known for a long time that what's-his-name running against Casey in Pennsylvania, McCormick, lives in Connecticut.
Right.
And got tied, by the way, today to some Russian financing stuff. But Mike Rogers, who's my old nemesis from Michigan, who's running against Alyssa Slotkin, mm-hmm. It was exposed that his Michigan registration, once he has already voted, is a house that is not occupied.
Wow. Yeah. And he owns a big $1.6 million oceanfront or gulffront, waterfront property in Florida, on the west coast of Florida, if it's still there, if Milton didn't destroy it. It's really frightening, and all the more reason why. Look, when I go out, as we've been moving, yesterday with the whole thing with the van breaking down and going into the shop where the guy came in with the Veterans for Trump t-shirt, I'm wearing a Harris t-shirt. And my husband engages everybody in, are you voting? You know, I don't talk to people because I'm kind of shy, but he does.
Kind of shy.
What's that?
I'm teasing you.
But I am. You know, I can talk on the radio. In person, I'm shy. People might think I'm standoffish or something. I'm just shy. But yeah. Anyway, you know, it's important that we talk to people, because I was shocked at how many people are totally disconnected. Oh, yeah, I'm going to register. Well, duh, it's too late. And I don't know who I'm voting for yet. Really? How can you not? And of course, the argument he used on the guys, the movers, was, if you ever want to get late again, you have no choice. And the guy's like, what? And he explained to him, had to explain to him that Trump overturned Roe, his machinations overturned Roe. They want to outlaw contraception. I mean, people, I guess, are just uninformed, and maybe for good reason, because they don't trust the news media. And yeah, I get it. It's a scary times we're in. Marcy Wheeler, other stuff happened this week. And again, Judge Chutkin once again shut down Trump's request for an appeal. Or what did she do?
So when Jack Smith, back on the 26th, submitted his initial brief on immunity, he submitted it under seal. And Chutkin ordered Trump to review the argument itself, the 165-page argument itself, over the course of a weekend and make specific redactions. And then she gave him until yesterday to review the appendix, which probably is at least 1,500 pages. And when the first deadline came around, he was like, I don't want any of this to become public. And she's like, sorry, you didn't make any specific redactions. It becomes public. That's right, how it became right. public. Mm-hmm. So then yesterday, same thing. They're supposed to submit actual contestation to redactions. And instead they're like, no, we don't want anything to become public, but give us some time to consider litigation. And she said, I'm ordering it to be released, but I'm staying that order for 7 days so that you can quote unquote consider litigation. So that's where it's at.
Okay.
What's interesting about it, and I've been out and about most of the day, but I haven't seen smart lawyers talking about the posture that puts it in. But there are two ways that Trump can prevent this from coming out. One is he can get an emergency temporary restraining order on it. And, he would have to go to the DC circuit and say, emergency, emergency, emergency. And then they would be like, what's the emergency? And he'd have to say, if you let these documents come out in my prosecution, I'll lose the election.
Well,
and you know, like, and then they'll say, give us the details. Why would you lose the election? Right. Well, because if voters know that I almost got Mike Pence killed, they'll vote against me. Like, that's one of the arguments. The other one is he could try writ of mandamus against Chutkin, except that writs of mandamus you can only get if you didn't have any other recourse to prevent some kind of damage. And he did, right? He was supposed to give redactions on this appendix. Instead of doing that, which is his initial recourse, which she gave him, mm-hmm. he instead said, I'm not giving you any redactions, I'm just going to whine. And so my guess is that mandamus would not work either. Plus the other thing is, like, in some cases when you try to mandamus a judge, the judge gets to weigh in. And in this case, she'd be just like, the Supreme Court told me to do this. Like, they literally said, go conduct a detailed analysis of the evidence. This is the evidence. I'm doing what the Supreme Court told me to do. So, you know, what Trump has done, and I don't want to rule out his legal shenanigans because they've always worked so far, yeah. But what Trump has done is create this position where, one, he's in a weak position legally, and two, he's going to have to go to somebody else and say, if you release this information publicly, it's going to, you know, voters are going to vote against me.
Right.
And then at some point it becomes like the Streisand effect, because you're effectively admitting that this information is disqualifying. Meanwhile, by the way, both Ellie Honig and Jack Goldsmith wrote these things that they were like, oh, violation of DOJ guidelines. I beat up on Ellie last week and, yeah. and Jack this week. They're both wrong. They're both wrong, first of all, because Jack Smith already told us in August that he was consulting about what he could do in response to the Supreme Court. He told us that in August.
Right.
He said, I need to do some consultations with other parts of DOJ about the timing of this. He told them that he was asking how to do this properly, how to follow DOJ rules properly. And they both say, we don't know. I'm like, well, read the fucking docket.
Right.
and then they're both like, oh, new information. And so because Jack Goldsmith did this in the New York Times and linked not New York Times to, you know, to substantiate his claim that there was bombshell information, I went through one by one and I'm like, dudes, this really isn't new information. The kind like one of the new pieces of information is Nick Luna rushes in to tell Trump, oh my God, they've just evacuated Mike Pence for his own safety. And Trump's response was, so what?
Right.
And that is new, but it is better sourced and far less damning information than Cassidy Hutchinson's testimony,
right.
That when Mark Meadows and Pat Cipollone, his White House counsel, when they went to him and said, Mike Pence is at great risk, Donald Trump responded by saying, well, I think he deserves it.
Yeah.
Like, so this is not damning information compared to the, I think he deserves it. It is just, this is the evidence that's going to come in about Trump's disinterest in the livelihood or the life of Mike Pence.
Right.
There are other instances where this stuff was revealed in court filings back in December, you know, do the work, and then you're going to find that while there is a bit of new information, most of it has been in here. Like some of what outlets claimed was new,
yeah,
is in the original indictment.
Right.
It's there,
but it
it's
hasn't
right there.
Been.
It's not new.
Right. But people haven't read it. And the media is not doing their job in reporting what's going on. You know, one other thing about the, you know, they're showing us that with Trump not wanting the evidence to come in because he'll lose the election because it shows all the shit that he's done. It's like J.D. Vance saying, well, you know, no fact check. You're not supposed to be fact checking, and then complaining that fact checking, that shutting down disinformation and misinformation is akin to censorship. That no, isn't the goal to get the truth out there? They're saying, no, you don't need those stinking truth. You're going to believe us and not your lying eyes or what. The whole thing is just, it's opposite world.
Yeah,
it's just astounding to me. This week, Marcy, you got really more into the weeds on the Jack Smith stuff. You did a podcast with Harry Littman that I encourage people to listen to. I haven't heard the whole thing, heard a little bit of it, but you've got that a link to that posted at emptywheel.net.
And shortly after I get off, of course, we tape at 12 noon
yes.
East Coast time.
Right.
I'm going to put up... LOL GOP has already released it, but our latest installment, we had to split it into two because I had so much to say about the way Barr killed the Mueller investigation.
Ah.
So the first half of that is out today, and I'll post that before I end up posting it. It'll be all podcasts all the time at emptywheel.net.
Oh, very cool.
But we go deep into the weeds on Bill Barr. And he does so much work. We have this hour conversation, he and I, this is how we
right.
do the podcast. And then he goes off and goes into the depths of right-wing YouTubes
Ooh.
To find, you know, he's like, oh, I found exactly what you said I would. I'm like, yeah. And so he found this crazy interview of Bill Barr that I had never seen. And Barr in it says, why would Russia want to collude with Trump? Why would they try and cultivate Trump? Why would these contacts with Trump's people matter? They don't need his help for a hack and leak.
Yeah.
It's the stupidest thing I've ever heard anyone say about the Russian investigation. And the reason Bill Barr has to say that, the reason Bill Barr has to say, I don't have to look at whether Vladimir Putin was cuddling up to Donald Trump, whether Vladimir Putin was manipulating Donald Trump by making requests of him that he knew the intelligence community would discover, but that Trump would lie to cover up, which is really that, that is why the Mike Flynn stuff mattered, because Russia knew that that was collected, and they, and Putin, by, you know, they knew this. Russia did this from the start. It was part of the operation from the start. And you're seeing it again back in the Woodward book. One of the big stories in the Woodward book was that Trump sent COVID testing machines to Putin.
Oh my
God. And you know, the focus is on that all of the rest of America wasn't getting COVID testing, but Vladimir Putin was. And that's an important part of the story. It goes along with Trump's disaster treatment, right? Like, he's going to take care of Vladimir Putin before he takes care of Americans, especially if they're in blue states. But the other important part of it was Putin said to him, don't tell anyone about this.
Yes.
You know, they'll be angry. And Putin said that to him, not because they'd really, I mean, they would be angry, but Putin said that to him so he'd have yet another secret that he and Donald Trump share. Uh-huh. And when this came out, the Kremlin was like, oh yeah, of course. Yeah, he sent us those machines. And Donald Trump is like, no, I didn't send that machine. And Putin does this. This is how Putin manipulates Donald Trump, because, you know, now Donald Trump is trying to deny it as if it's a bad thing. And we all know that Vladimir Putin has Donald Trump's nuts in a vice.
Yep.
Donald Trump has weakly capitulated to Vladimir Putin in front of the entire world. And the only one who thinks he's pulling off a fast one is Donald Trump himself.
Yeah. I mean, I often talk about my brain exploding, but it's just overloaded with this stuff that just doesn't make any sense. And yeah, there's that. So the Ball of Thread podcast with Marcy Wheeler and LOL GOP Jason Sattler, you'll have posted at emptywheel.net. You've got the Harry Littman one. Obviously, I hope people are listening to this. And I did speak with Christopher Steele on Wednesday. Go figure. The equipment worked. You know, it wasn't the most, journalistic, filled interview. However, he did say that he still stands by everything that he wrote, and that he would not have, if it were today, he'd still do it. And I did ask him about the P tape, and he said, look, it's standard operating procedure for the Russians. This is the shit they do. I asked him who his sources were. He really didn't answer, but he stands by it. So there's that. So that is posted at NicoleSandler.com if anyone wants to listen to that one. And I guess that's it for now. Next week, Marcy, I promise my studio will be working, and we'll have video again too.
Yay.
All right. Well, thank you so much.
It sucks to move.
Ugh, it's the worst. This has not been fun, but hopefully the worst is behind. Well, once we get the stuff out of the van that's in the shop with the busted transmission, you know.
Oh my God.
It's been one of those weeks or months. So anyway, to be continued. Hopefully next week I'll be a lot happier.
Cool.
Anyway, thank
Have
you.
Have a good one.
Marcy Wheeler, emptywheel.net. As always, thank you, and I'll talk to you next week. And to everyone listening, thanks for bearing with me, and we'll see you Monday. Peace out.
These are the sounds of crushed souls. The sounds of despair from former radio personalities languishing in the purgatory of corporate consolidation. These former radio personalities have lost their livelihoods, not because they weren't entertaining or informative, but because they don't meet today's corporate terrestrial broadcast standards of being smelly, overweight douchebags, seething with vein-popping hatred. These radio refugees and their audiences have since migrated to the internet, but their struggle continues as the quest for monetization ensues. Nicole Sandler is leading the way to reestablishing thought-provoking and entertaining radio. And you can help by clicking the donate button on NicoleSandler.com. Donate today, or as much and as often as you can. Dry the tears of listeners by removing the rotting stench of corporate radio. Won't you help?